Big, gentle giant.
At just 15, Cassius Turvey was already a pillar of his community.
Oh, yeah. Cassius was born a pop, you know, blackfella style, you know, and born an uncle.
He and his mates ran a pay-what-you-can lawn-mowing service in their spare time.
He looks after everyone and he just has this beautiful gift of making people smile and laugh and uplifting people.
Next song is Animal Song. She nailed it.
He had big dreams for the future.
So I'm on the radio learning. When I grow up a little bit, I'm going to get a job. So this is what I'm doing this year.
But that future was taken from him. It's now 2 weeks since Cassius and his friends were allegedly ambushed in broad daylight as they walked to the shops after school. Cassius was hospitalised with serious head injuries. He died on Sunday.
Heartbroken for my son. We only buried his father a month ago.
Police will allege that 21-year-old Jack Brearley chased Cassius and struck him with a metal pole. Despite claims from Cassius's friends that racial slurs were heard before the attack, police are not treating the incident as racially motivated.
We're not operating on any principles of racism or motivation at this point, other than to say we believe there was a damage incident that occurred and that resulted in the murder of a very young boy.
But there's no suggestion Cassius had anything to do with that earlier incident.
It may be a case of mistaken identity. It may be a case of being in the wrong place at the wrong time.
That explanation proving hard to swallow for many.
Aboriginal children should be safe in public space. They should be safe walking along the street. That's all he was doing, walking while visibly black.
No black child should fear walking home from school. And no black mother should wonder if their child will return home.
You're an Indigenous boy, you know, they're going to look at you, just, I guess, try and be smaller. And I hate that I had to explain that to my son.
Amid that frustration, anger at the deafening silence in some quarters of the media. Most of all, outrage at the lack of outrage over yet another young Indigenous life cut tragically and brutally short.
I'm sorry that we are here again with yet another justice hashtag for the loss of another black life.
That's hard to watch. I mean, I think the most important thing to think about with all of this is a kid who's 15. He had dreams and hopes and aspirations. We saw how chuffed he was doing his radio bit.
Yeah.
That's gone. It's not Hollywood enough. It's not Hollywood enough for Australian public and Australian media to care. I'm so glad we've opened with this. I didn't know we were going to. I'm so glad we have. And there's a couple more points I really want to hit on. First thing is people think that we're getting better. Oh, we've come so far. We've come so far. Deaths in custody has gone up since Black Lives Matter all happened. We've seen what it's been like to be a black fella in the last little bit. We'll be talking about some more stuff a little bit later on. And there's never action, there's only talk. And ultimately, we don't want to talk about how this is a racial incident, but ultimately, when it's all boiled down to, the value of property has been deemed more than the life of a 15-year-old black kid. The value of property. I mean, what kind of a joint are we living in? What kind of backwater are we living in if that's the case? How do you think families are feeling sending their kids out? It's disgusting. I'm so angry. I know a lot of mobs really upset as well, and my heart goes out to the family as well.
And the police saying that he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. This was a teenager in his school uniform in broad daylight walking the street.
Where else are you supposed to be other than walking home in your school kit? I mean,
and he's running. Like, he's running. And how far did he have to run to be in the right place?
Yeah, it's, you know. My heart is broken, like a lot of people's.